In this Pathfinder Wrath of the Righteous video, we're going to be covering the next five classes that are in the game, and these are Inquisitor, Kineticist, Magus, Monk, and Oracle. First up is the Inquisitor. This is a divine spellcasting class, kind of like the Cleric, that uses Wisdom in order to, for its spellcasting ability modifier, so you're going to need a good amount of Wisdom in order to use this class effectively. And it also has a ton of class skills, meaning you're going to be able to do a lot of different things throughout the game with this class. Inquisitors are proficient with all simple weapons, plus longbows, shortbows, and the favored weapon of their deity, and also proficient with light armor, medium armor, and shields, except tower shields. Just like clerics during character creation, they're going to choose a deity, and this is going to determine what domains they can choose from, and they're going to get to select one domain. A couple of things that set this class apart from cleric are that it has orisons, which are basically level 0 spells that are like cantrips that they can cast without consuming a spell slot, so they're going to be able to cast these over and over. Additionally, they excel at intimidation, so if you want to play an intimidating character, then the Inquisitor is not a bad class. And they have an ability called Judgment, which allows them to buff their group with attack rolls or damage rolls or armor class once per day, increasing the amount of times they can do this as they level up. And that will last for the duration of one combat encounter, and as this gets more powerful throughout the game, they'll be able to do more than one Judgment at a time, so they're going to be able to buff their group periodically. And also, just like clerics, they can't be atheists or Rahadam faithless. So again, this doesn't really apply to character creation, but it may apply to characters that are, you know, if you're looking to multi-class, you may not be able to multi-class some of your companions into this class. The Faith Hunter subclass of Inquisitor allows them to select a sworn enemy, but unlike other classes, this is not a specific sworn enemy. In fact, it's going to be the opposite of one of their alignments. So if they're chaotic, then this would be lawful, or if they're good, then this would be evil. So they're going to have a whole bunch of enemies that are going to be their sworn enemies that they're going to gain bonuses against. The Monster Tactician subclass of Inquisitor allows them to do all the things that the Inquisitor can do, but also summon creatures to the battlefield. So if you want to be sort of a hybrid between an Inquisitor and a Summoner, this is a good subclass. The Sacred Huntsmaster subclass of Inquisitor allows them to not only have an animal companion, much like the Hunter class, but also allows them a favored enemy like the Ranger. So they're going to select an enemy type that they're going to gain a bonus with their attack and damage rolls against. The Sanctified Slayer subclass of Inquisitor allows them to have the sneak attack passive, so they're going to be able to deal sneak attack damage much like a rogue. So if you want to be able to be a sneaky Inquisitor or Inquisitor that does extra damage, this is not a bad choice. The Tactical Leader subclass of Inquisitor allows them to gain extra teamwork feats and to be able to use abilities that buff their party members in battle. So if you want to be Inquisitor that has exceptionally good at buffing your party, this is a very good subclass to choose. The Kineticist class is not a spellcaster technically in Pathfinder Wrath of the Righteous, though it does use something called Wild Talents that works similarly to the way spells work. In this case though, instead of drawing upon a spellcasting ability modifier like Wisdom or Intelligence to make their spell more powerful, they can take damage to themselves in order to increase the effect of some spells. This means that most Kineticists are going to have a high health pool or high constitution in order to draw from, because you cannot heal the damage spent this way, and it's only cleared when you rest. So your health pool is effectively going to become the resource used to cast your spells and take damage from, so you're going to have to manage it carefully. Each Kineticist is also going to have to choose at the beginning which element they want to focus on, whether it's fire, air, earth, or water, and they'll be able to choose more as the game goes on, but you're going to start out with one of those, and that's going to determine what spells or wild talents you'll gain. Kineticists are proficient with all simple weapons, light armor, but not shields, so they're not going to be using weapons a ton, but they're going to be focused on using their abilities as much as they can. The Blood Kineticist specializes in using abilities or infusing their wild talents with blood abilities, you know, things that set bleeding or do physical damage or have vampiric properties, but they are regulated to only using the water element because water and blood are similar. So they can only manipulate the water element in order to do this, so they're going to be regulated to that, but then they're going to gain added benefits to those abilities. The Dark Elementalist subclass of Kineticist allows them to channel the burn damage that they would take from using their wild talent into corpses around them, so they can basically deflect some of that damage. The downside is that they cannot spend as much of their HP to increase the damage of their wild talents or their spells as the regular Kineticist class. So your trade-off is that you're not going to take as much damage, but you're not going to deal as much damage. The Kinetic Knight subclass of the Kineticist basically is specializing in melee frontline combat by giving you an ability called Kinetic Blade that allows you to spend your wild talent in sort of a melee attack. You're also going to gain proficiencies with medium and heavy armor, as well as shields. So if you want to be tankier and you want to be like a melee character, like full on that uses these, abilities, then this is a good subclass for you. The Overwhelming Soul subclass focuses on reducing the damage that you take from casting your wild talents or spells, but in exchange you're not able to expend further health in order to increase the damage that they deal. So that's the trade-off there. And additionally, your wild talents are going to use your charisma modifier instead of your constitution modifier for their DC check. So if you want to play a more charismatic character or use charisma instead of constitution, then this is a good subclass for you. The psychokineticist uses this wisdom modifier instead of constitution modifier for the DC and damage of wild talents and spells. So if you want to play a kineticist but use wisdom instead of constitution, or wisdom instead of charisma like the Overwhelming Soul, this is a good choice for you. And additionally, instead of taking some damage, you can actually take penalties to wisdom checks in exchange for, you know, preventing that damage, which you may or may want to do depending on the situation. The Magus class in Pathfinder Wrath of the Righteous is an arcane spellcaster, meaning that they use intelligence for their spellcasting ability modifier. But you should probably look at the Magus class as more of like a spellblade if you want to define what it is. It's a combination of a spellcaster and melee warrior. Magus are proficient with simple and martial weapons as well as light armor, and they can cast spells while wearing light armor without incurring the arcane spell failure chance. But if they wear medium and heavy armor or shields, then this will be added to their spell, so you don't want to do this unless you take the appropriate feats. A couple of things that really define the Magus class. The first is Arcane Pool. This allows them to buff their weapon a certain amount of times a day based on their level and their intelligence ability modifier. And they're going to use this in combat to deal more damage and to connect easier. So that's the first thing. Secondly, if they have a one-handed weapon in one hand, or a light one-handed weapon in one hand and nothing in the other hand, they can actually attack with a melee attack and cast a spell if they don't move. So if you're up in front of a creature or enemy and you don't need to move, you can attack with your weapon and then still cast the spell, which is awesome. And lastly, the spell strike ability actually allows them to infuse their weapon with a spell and then melee attack. So they're not only going to get the damage from the melee attack, but also the spell. And this is great to use if you've already moved, because then you're going to get that spell and melee attack at the same time. The Armored Battle Mage subclass of Magus allows them to use medium and heavy armor, as well as become very good with armor itself, so it will provide more protection and less penalties. And they also gain the ability Arcane Armor, which provides them with an armor bonus using their Arcane Pool, much like the Arcane weapon buff that they had. So they're going to be able to be very, very tanky while still casting spells and dealing damage with melee. The Eldritch Archer subclass of Magus essentially allows you to do the same thing that Maguses can do by casting a spell and attacking with their melee weapon if they don't move. But now you can do the same thing if you have a ranged weapon equipped. So maybe you have a bow, you can fire your bow and then cast a spell if you don't move. And you can also infuse the attack with your bow with a spell, much like you could with the melee attack instead. The Eldritch Scion subclass allows the Magus to gain access to a bloodline. They get to choose which one they want during character creation. And this is going to open up a whole slew of other abilities that they're going to gain, and that's going to depend on what bloodline they choose. For instance, if they chose a draconic bloodline, then they would have abilities that would be based on, you know, having dragon blood. And if they chose like a fire dragon, then these would also have fire abilities, or an ice dragon would have ice abilities. It really depends on what you pick. There's just a lot to go through, so I'm not going to go through all of those. But it's basically going to open up a bunch of abilities based on the bloodlines, and you can look through those and see what they are. The Hexcrafter subclass allows the Magus to gain access to all 6th-level spells or lower that have the curse descriptor in them. So he's going to be able to cast curses, and also gain access to a limited number of witch spells, which are different than the spell list that a Magus normally has. So if you want more spells, and specifically ones that are going to debuff enemies, then this is a subclass for you. The Sword Satan subclass of Magus allows them to choose a single exotic or martial weapon that they become proficient with and gain weapon focus in. The idea being that you're going to focus on using that one weapon type. You can gain other proficiencies, obviously, but the idea is that you're going to focus heavily on that weapon type, and you're going to gain abilities in combat that make you more and more devastating by adding things like your intelligence modifier to some of your damage rolls or your crit rolls, increasing your effectiveness with that weapon, and just dealing effectively more and more damage as the game goes on with a specific weapon type. The Monk is a martial class in Pathfinder Wrath of the Righteous, and as one might expect based on other games, it focuses very heavily on unarmed combat and stunning enemies and attacking with fists. So if you want to play an unarmed class, then this is definitely the way to go. Monks have a huge focus on wisdom. A lot of their abilities use wisdom in order to determine what they can do or how many times they can use it. And additionally, they gain an armor class bonus based on their wisdom modifier, so you're going to want to have high wisdom if you're playing a monk. The Scaled Fist subclass of monk allows the monk to gain certain powers from dragons. They're going to gain extra feats that apply to combat. Some of them are dragon related. And they're also going to be able to like imbue their attacks with dragon energy, in order to deal extra damage. So if you want to play like sort of like a hybrid dragon monk, this is like the subclass for you. The Sensei subclass of monk allows them to use Bard's Inspirations as well as attack with unarmed attacks. So if you want to play sort of a hybrid between a bard and a monk without the spell casting, then this is the class for you. The Sohei subclass of monk allows them to use mounts in combat as well as provides them with some martial weapon training so that they can use weapons. Sohei literally translates to warrior monk in Japanese. So if you want to play a monk that, you know, rides in the combat in horse and mount or whatever and uses weapons instead of fists, then this might be the subclass for you. The traditional monk subclass trades some choice of key powers from some very specific powerful key powers that are obtained over the levels that are, you know, very conducive of a monk style of play. So if you want to have some more powerful but very specific, so less flexibility but more power, then this is a good choice for you. The Zen Archer subclass of monk allows them to use bows very effectively. One of the things that monks can do is use flurry of blows when they're unarmed, meaning that they can attack twice if they don't move. That applies to Zen Archer as well if they're using a bow, so if they don't move, they're actually going to get to shoot twice, which is extremely powerful, and they also gain proficiency with the different bow types. So if you want to play sort of a hybrid between a monk that, you know, uses monk abilities, but also uses a ranged weapon, then this is a good subclass for you. The Oracle is a divine spellcasting class in Pathfinder Wrath of the Righteous, which means they use their wisdom ability modifier for their spells, so they're going to have high wisdom. And they are proficient with all simple weapons, light armor, medium armor, and shields, except tower shields. Now, what's particularly interesting about the Oracle is that at first level, when you're making your Oracle character, you're going to choose a curse. This is going to give your character a negative effect, but also give you several positive effects as well. So it's really going to define how your Oracle plays, and you should really look through these and spend some time because they can be quite devastating and also really good. Oracles also gain over time what are called mysteries. And these provide benefits to the character, such as abilities or more class skills, etc. And you're going to gain these every second level, so all throughout the game you're going to be getting more and more powerful through these mysteries. Additionally, they're going to gain something called revelations that are basically like abilities that they need to choose from. These are going to have DC saves against with their charisma modifier, so they're also going to want to have a decent amount of charisma as well as wisdom. And you're going to have to select through the list. These are all unique as for the Oracle, as far as I know. So you'll have to look through the list as it's quite long and figure out what you want, and you're going to gain more and more of these throughout the game. The last thing that Oracles also get is they get to choose whether they want all spells added to their spell list with the Cure in their name or Inflict in their name. So you can either be a healing Oracle or a damage dealing Oracle in that regard, but once you've made that choice, you cannot change it. The Divine Herbalist subclass specializes a bit in healing. They can brew potions. They're going to use their charisma modifier to affect certain healing spells, and they're going to gain abilities that provide healing. So if you want to play a healing oracle, then this is not a bad choice. The Enlightened Philosopher subclass has an ability called Mental Acuity, which allows you to gain +1 intelligence at the moment you select it, and then every 3 levels thereafter, so you're going to gain quite a bit of intelligence throughout the course of the game. Since you are a divine spellcasting class that uses wisdom and also needs charisma for certain things, intelligence isn't particularly useful, outside of the fact that it works with skill checks and also provides you more skill points. Basically, if you're picking the Enlightened Philosopher subclass, you're doing so in order to be more proficient with skills around, you know, the activities that you'll do throughout the game. The Lone Strider subclass of Oracle allows you to move faster on the battlefield and eventually even be able to teleport several times a day. And additionally, it allows you to sort of conceal yourself by a certain amount when there are no enemies within a certain range. So if you want to play more of a like stealthy, fast-moving Oracle, then the Lone Strider is for you. The Possessed Oracle subclass allows you to gain bonuses to prevent mind-altering effects, so you're going to have increased saving throws against those sort of things. And it's also going to give you a very unique curse that makes you staggered for the first round of combat, but after that you're going to have a lot of bonuses to dodge. So you're going to have to decide whether that's worth that for you or not. The Seeker subclass of Oracle essentially gives them bonus feats that are going to improve their spell casting in some way. There's a certain subset of feats that they can take. Most of them are related to casting. So if you want to improve certain aspects of your spellcasting with the Oracle, then this is a good subclass to choose. That's it for this video. We went through another five classes in Pathfinder Wrath of the Righteous. Be sure to check out our other videos. There's going to be five videos in total that go through all the classes, and then we'll have a special video on the prestige classes. We're going to go through all these classes more in depth at launch of the game, showing some gameplay, how to use each class specifically, as well as their subclasses and why you might not use them. But in the next video, you can look out for Paladin, Ranger, Rogue, Shaman, and Skull. And be sure to check out the official wiki if you have questions about the game.